So welcome everyone to this week's seminar. Today's seminar speaker is Dr. Xiaoli Dong. She's an assistant professor in the Department of Environmental Sciences and Policy at UC Davis. Dr. Xiaoli Dong studies the spatial self-organization and emergent properties of ecosystems at multiple scales. And her general questions of interest are, how do local interactions among ecological agents give rise to emergent properties at the landscape scale? And how does geomorphic evolution of landscapes interact with biological evolution of organisms at the timescale relevant to both processes? Therefore, her lab integrates mathematical modeling, monitoring, and experimental data collected from the field to develop general theoretical frameworks to understand how natural ecosystems work. Dr. Xiaoli Dong did a PhD in landscape ecology at the Arizona State University and then a postdoc at the Heffernan Lab at Duke University. Today, she's gonna talk about the spatial self-organization of ecosystems, patterns, processes, and feedbacks. And before we start, a reminder on how the seminar is going to go. Xiaoli will give the talk, and if you have questions, please type them into the chat box that is at the bottom of the screen. And after the talk, I will read the questions for Xiaoli. Please keep your cameras and microphone off. The seminar of next week will be by Dr. Jesse Lassie, a research oceanographer from the Pacific Coastal and Marine Sciences Center in Santa Cruz, from UCSGS. And the talk title is Influence of Invasive Submerged Aquatic Vegetation on Currents and Sediment Transport in the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta. With that, I would like to hand it over to Xiaoli, and I hope you enjoy the seminar.
Okay, thank you, Aurora, for the introduction. And thank you everyone for coming to my talk and this opportunity for me to talk about my research. So what I'm going to talk about is the pattern formation, and it is mostly the work that I did when I was a postdoc at Duke University and in collaboration with Jim Heffernan and Brad Murray at Duke, and then Matt Cohen from University of Florida. So the spatial pattern that I'm going to talk about here in this talk is about this landscape. You see that, so this is Big Cypress National Preserve in South Florida. In this landscape, you see that there's these green mounds that's scattered around across this whole landscape. And these green mounds are called cypress domes. They are evenly spaced across this landscape. And this NSF funded project was trying to figure out what is the mechanism that caused this spatial pattern of these cypress domes. So let's step back a little bit first and to talk about my research program. Overall, I have been really interested in spatial heterogeneity and pattern formation. And spatial heterogeneity has been observed in all kinds of ecosystems, from terrestrial to aquatic. And the key theme of my dissertation was to look at three categories of the drivers. They are template effect, self-organization, and stochasticity. How these three drivers give rise to all kinds of spatial patterns that we observe in ecosystem. In particular, in this talk, I'm going to focus on self-organization. So let's just go through some simple definition here first. First is template effect. What it means is that spatial pattern emerges as a response to the underlying pre-existing spatial characteristics. So for example, a classic example would be this vertical zonation that we see in the intertidal zone as well as in mountains. So in mountains, we see that the spatial distribution of the vegetation is a reflection of the underlying physical templates, which includes like soil texture gradient, soil moisture gradient, precipitation, temperature gradient. Another example in California here is the serpentine outcrops. So the spatial distribution of certain types of the plant community is really just tracking the underlying bedrock distribution of this particular type of the bedrock in serpentine outcrops. So this is template effect. Then the question is, what if the template effect is not there? Like, what if the landscape is completely homogeneous? Can we still get pattern? And so this is a question. And then the answer is yes. And it is through the process called self-organization. Self-organization is a process in which spatial patterns at the global scale of the system emerge solely from local interactions among the individual agents. So let's watch this very short video to see, to give you a feel of what self-organization is. So what you are looking at here is muscles. And this is a lab experiment. And you put, at the initial condition, you put these muscles on a completely homogeneous lab platform, and you let them stay there. They are going to move around and eventually form this pattern after about 10 hours. So this process of this interaction among the muscles themselves giving rise to this pattern, this process is called self-organization. And so this is what they look like in real world at different spatial scales formed by these muscle interactions. So this is not a reflection of any underlying template effect. It's purely just self-organized. And the mechanism behind self-organization is called scale-dependent feedback. And it is actually discovered by this mathematician in 1950s, Alan Turing. And the, he published this mathematical model in this seminal paper called The Chemical Basis of Morphogenesis. And the question that he tried to address in this paper was, is there a unifying mathematical formula that we can use to describe the spatial pattern that we see on animal skin, those regular patterns that we see on animal skin, such as on tiger, on zebra? And so in this paper, he put forth this set of basically just two PDEs that can be used to describe all kinds of regular patterns on animal skin. So let me show you using an ecological example to show you how this works. So imagine in a water-limited ecosystem. So first, the scale-dependent feedback just means that locally, it's at small scale, it's positive feedback. And at longer scale, it's negative feedback. So that's why it's scale-dependent. So imagine it's a water-limited ecosystem, like in drylands, desert. We have a plant that's growing in one spot, and it's going to modify the soil environment locally, and then it's going to take up more water from the area surrounding it. And that water, water concentration is going to be higher under this plant, and that's going to make the plant grow better. And because this whole system is water limited, now if the plant water is getting attracted to this spot, that means the places that's nearby it is getting even more water limited, such that within this zone of inference, of negative inference by this first plant, the second plant would not be able to grow there because it's too water limited. And it can only grow in the place where this negative inference by the first plant fades out. So if you repeat this process in space, you will get regular spaced vegetation pattern. And one thing that's really important here is that this system has to be resource limited. So imagine if the system is not, so in this particular case, is not water limited, then this mechanism would not work. Okay, so this is what self-organized vegetation look like in real ecosystems. And this set of maps shows the spatial distribution of this regular pattern of vegetation globally. Mostly they are distributed in places where it's arid or semi-arid, and we see a lot of them in Australia and the southern border of the Sahara Desert. And I think in the United States, there's only one place there's this kind of regular pattern of vegetation, which is located at the border of Texas and Mexico. So this is the regular pattern vegetation, but self-organization occurs not only in vegetation, it also occurs in other types of ecosystem. So what we are seeing here, a set of the pictures showing different types of self-organization. This one on the top left is the termite mounds. They are regular patterned. This is fairy circles. So what these circles, inside the circles is bare ground, bare sand. There's no vegetation growing. And outside of the circles, there's grasses. And these circles are about 10 to 20 meters in radius, and they are evenly spaced across landscape. This is ribbon forest. The spacing among the these tree bands are even. And what you are seeing on the lower right is a redox pattern that's observed in soil profile. This is a project that I'm working on, collaborating with Dan Richter from Duke. And this is a zooming picture of this, and these red bands and gray bands, they are evenly spaced and only occur at a certain depths of the soil. And so these red bands are the oxidized iron. So some of you might know this term called Lisa Gang banding, and this is a phrase to describe this kind of regular patterned bands in rocks. But I was surprised to find that there's no report of this kind of banding in soil. And one big difference between this kind of banding in the rocks and the soil is that in soil, all the process are very sensitive to hydrology. So think about the redox condition in soil. It's going to be super sensitive to hydrology, biological process, which are not there in rocks. So we have several sites, and some sites don't have this kind of banding at all, and some sites do show this kind of banding, and some banding occur at very shallow soil depth, and other bandings occur at very deep soil depths. So the project is to look at the interaction between hydrological processes and the emergence of this kind of banding in soil, and as well as what it does to the soil property. Okay, so these are a range of the patterns caused by self-organization. Then the next question is, why do we care about these kind of patterns other than they look nice and mysterious? Well, there are at least two reasons that we need to care about these kind of self-organized patterns. First is that it has very significant ecological consequence. It changes the resilience of the system. It changes the productivity of the system as well as biodiversity of the system. So there's a lot of research to look at the ecological consequence of this kind of pattern formation. This particular study is looking at the resilience of the system with the self-organized termite mounds. And with this layer of the mounds, it basically is shifting the threshold of the ecosystem collapse to a much lower rainfall value. So it increases the resilience of the system, this grassland system, to climate change. So that's the ecological consequence. It also has some evolutionary consequence. And so this example here, this study by De Jager et al. Is showing the evolutionary consequence of pattern formation. So this is about the muscle pattern formation. So the one that you saw in the video. And if you put the muscles on the platform, as you saw in the video, they are going to move around and to form the pattern. And there are different ways the muscles can move. You can do the random walk, like the Brownian walk, or you can do the levy walk, which is like small strikes, and then after a few small strikes, you have a very long strike. So that's levy walk. And there's different types of levy walk, like different exponent. And so they set up a camera and to see what kind of walk these muscles that's forming patterning are taking. And what they found is that the particular walk these muscles take on is the one that minimizes the time for them to form the pattern. So what is the implication of that? The implication is that it means that self-organization is promoting the cooperation among individuals that are not genetically related. So this is one of the examples of the evolutionary consequence of the self-organization. So this is one direction of my research program is taking. I become really interested in the evolutionary and biological implications of this kind of self-organization. So we had a paper last year to look at to set up a conceptual framework for the evolutionary implications of ecosystem self-organization. And this year, I did a metadata analysis. This paper was just submitted a couple of weeks ago. What I did was I searched, I looked at different types of self-organization and looked at the species that are involved in self-organization. The question of the wonder that I had at that time was like, I was thinking in a particular place that is suitable for pattern formation to occur, are all the species equally likely to get involved in self-organization, or is it like some species are more likely to do that? If it is some species are more likely to do self-organization, what makes them more likely to do that? Is there some traits that are conducive for pattern formation? So this is what I did, and the simple answer is this, is yes, there are certain traits that can actually make certain species that are more likely to get involved in self-organization. And I found that there's a very high conservation of the species identity across different regions to get involved in self-organization. Okay, so now let's move back to this landscape of Big Cypress that I just showed you in South Florida. And I'm going to talk about what kind of mechanisms that give rise to this pattern formation in Big Cypress National Preserve in South Florida. In this landscape, the only driver that's giving rise to the pattern is self-organization. Just a little bit about the system. So this is where the system is. So this is Big Cypress National Preserve, and it is just west of the Everglades National Park. So this is the Lake Okeechobee. And so the whole landscape is very flat. The relief is about 3 to 4 centimeters every kilometer. And so water is flowing from Lake Okeechobee all the way to the ocean. And for some part of the year, the whole system, including Big Cypress and the Everglades National Park, are inundated by surface water. There's a lot of patterned vegetation in these systems, such as the ridge slough patterns in Everglades and this kind of cypress dome patterns in the Big Cypress National Preserve. Let's focus on the Big Cypress National Preserve. This is a snapshot from Google Earth to look at landscape. Let's just zoom in to see what they look like. You see these like gray point dots that's embedded in this green matrix. These green matrix are pine trees. And if you zoom in, this is a cypress dome. And in the center, there's a hole in it. And I'm going to talk about what is forming that. And each dome, this is about 40 to 50 meters in radius, and they are evenly spaced from each other. Each dome is evenly spaced from each other. This is the cross-section view of a cypress dome. So it gets its name dome because of the dome shape of this above-ground biomass. So the trees, the cypress trees in the center is taller than the ones on the edge. So it forms this dome shape. But if you look below ground, I mean, not below ground, if you go into the center of this dome, you will find that it is actually a mirror image of this dome shape. So underneath it, it's a depression. And so in the center of this dome, so imagine if you are walking from the edge of this dome into the center, you will find that the water is getting deeper and deeper because underneath is a depression. And this depression is formed by weathering, and because this whole landscape is located on an exposed cast bedrock or limestone bedrock. And so this depression is a weathering depression. And this is what it looks like inside a dome. Another thing that I want to mention here is that, so imagine if your water dries out, this tree is going to experience more dry stress than the ones in the center because there's more water in the center. So we did some tree ring counting of these trees, and we found that the trees on the edge is shorter than the ones in the center, not because they are younger. It is because these trees are almost about the same age. And the ones on the edge is shorter is because they are more water limited. Okay, so let's first address the first question, which is, are these domes or depressions really evenly spaced? So we did some spatial statistics, different types of spatial statistics actually, and we found that these domes are indeed evenly spaced across the whole landscape. And we also analyzed the number of the neighbors surrounding each depression. And we found that on average, each depression is surrounded by another six depressions. So these depressions are in hexagonal packing, which means that is a very efficient way of using space, hexagonal packing. And I mean, this suggests there might be some competition going on among these depressions for space. So this established that the depressions are evenly spaced across the landscape. Now the question is, what causes these depressions and why they are evenly spaced across the whole landscape? We address this question at three different spatial scales. The first scale is at the soil-rock interface scale. At this scale, we build a reactive transport kinetics model to figure out how old this landscape is and what kind of process are involved. So the logic behind the model is that if we can model the weathering rate, then it will tell us the mean annual weathering rate for this under this kind of conditions in this landscape. Another piece of information is that we know that for most of the domes in the center, the depression is about 2 meters. So if we know the weathering rate, we know it's 2 meters of the bedrock has already been weathered, then we can estimate how old this landscape is when this landscape starts to be weathered. So that's the first question. And the second question is at the individual depression scale. At this scale, we want to know what is controlling the size of individual depressions. What are they going to look like in the future? And so we had a second model to address that. And in the last project, we did a landscape evolution model to address the last question, which is what causes overdispersion of these depressions across landscape? So let's start with the first one. So we have to build a model that to estimate the weathering rate in under the condition of the South Florida. We start off with the weathering process. There are three key rate limiting process in limestone weathering. First is the conversion of the CO2 to carbonic acid. And second is the dissolution of the limestone. And third is the export of the weathering product out of the system. All these processes rely on water, and it's the rate of this process are very sensitive to water. So because of that, we explicitly modeled the hydrological condition of the system. The three key hydrological states of the system. First is that when the whole system is covered by surface water, so every depression is connected. And then water dries out, then the depressions become isolated from each other, but there's still water in the center of it. And deep into the dry season, then the center of the depressions can get also dried out. So these three stage of hydrological states. In particular, one of the process is very sensitive to this hydrological state or the soil moisture, which is this transport of the CO2. So weathering process is really the process of acid dissolved by calcium carbonate, right? So CO2 has to move to the surface of calcium carbonate, which is covered by this soil in the center of the depression. So CO2 has to go through the soil to get to the depression, to the bedrock surface for weathering to occur. And this movement or transport of the CO2 is very sensitive to water. So let's just go through this equation here. CO2 movement includes two key processes. First is the diffusion, and another is advection. And so the diffusion, it can be diffusion in the form of the gas CO2 and dissolved CO2. One thing to notice here is that CO2 moves, diffuses a lot faster in gas form than dissolved form, like several orders of magnitude faster. And so as soil dries out, there's more air space in soil now. So diffusion, CO2 is going to leave the system in the gas form through the outer, through the upper boundary, which is going from the soil to the atmosphere. So less CO2 is actually going to move downwards to get to the bedrock surface. So that's the diffusion part. And the second part is the advection part. CO2 can also move to soil surface in the form of the dissolved CO2 moving through, moving with water flow. And there's two head gradients that decide the advection rate. One is the elevation head, which basically is the gravity is pouring water downward, right? And second is the pressure head. So as soil dries out, the capillary force is which is pouring water upwards is going to get stronger and stronger, which means that this pressure head going downward is getting smaller and smaller. If the soil is really dry, then this arrow can even flip the direction from moving downward to moving upward. So that means, what that means is that as soil dries out from left to right, there's diffusion going downward is reduced, advection going downward is reduced. So which means less CO2 is going to move to the bedrock surface for weathering. And so this is why we have to explore the model hydrology or here the soil moisture change so that we can capture the weathering rate. And so we build a model that includes basically four modules. First is the soil transport and the kinetics of the weathering and hydrology and the CO2 production by biological process, which includes root respiration and decomposition. And what we need from this model is really just one thing, which is the average weathering rate. And because we know that it's 2 meters, so 2 meters divided by that average weathering rate, we can figure out what might be the age of the landscape. So what is the age? The age is about 9,000 years, which means that the landscape started to develop into its the current morphology started about at the end of the last glacier maximum. And that makes sense because when at the end of the last glacier maximum, which is about 9 to 10,000 years ago, that's when sea level rises and groundwater table also gets can be pushed towards the surface of the bedrock, and then the landscape start to be able to hold surface water, and then this biology process start to take off. And we also had several other methods to calculate, to infer the age of the landscape, and all these different methods seem to match in terms of the number for the age of the landscape. And so there's also some other output from the model, like we looked at how different variables can influence weathering rate of this limestone. Like we looked at the effect of the rainfall on the weathering rate. So these solid points just represent condition of the South Florida. So if the places get more wetter, then the weathering rate is increasing. And this is the groundwater drainage rate influencing the weathering rate. As groundwater drainage rate increases, it will accelerate the weathering rate because groundwater drainage provides a way to export the weathering products. If the weathering product can't be exported, then they are going to reprecipitate. And so increasing the drainage rate can accelerate the weathering rate. But at some point, when the drainage rate is too fast, it's going to shorten the hydro period and the system gets drier, so that's going to reduce the weathering rate at some point. And then we looked at the effect of like the amount of the dry mass, root dry mass on the weathering rate. More root, higher weathering rate, because you have more root respiration providing CO2, which provides the acid for the weathering. And this is the architecture of the root. So if the root is shallower, then that's reduced the weathering rate, because if the root is shallower, the pathway from the root zone to the bedrock is longer, then the weathering rate is reduced. We also looked at the relative importance of these different drivers. So the way you look at this figure is that when the variable is located more upper right, that means that variable is more important for the weathering. So like these first order of these variables include some of these biological variables like root mass, root vertical distribution, and soil thickness. So for this particular landscape, biology plays a really important role. What we found is that if we remove the cypress trees from this landscape, it's going to greatly slow down the weathering rate. Actually, the biological respiration accelerated limestone weathering by about 20 times. So if the cypress trees were not there, this is what the landscape would have looked like now for the big cypress. It's just limestone pavement. So we coined this phrase, ecological jail, to describe this phenomenon that biological process accelerating the creation of these kind of depressions. This study also supports a hypothesis that was raised by Bell Dietrich and Taylor Perron, the paper published in 2006 in Nature. What the question they tried to address in that paper was that what would the landscape morphology look like if life never arose on Earth? And so the hypothesis or the argument they tried to make in that paper was that basically the morphology, the topography that we will have if there were never life on Earth would be the same. We are going to see same set of topography on Earth, except the distribution of the different types of the topography is going to be very different without life. So what we see in our study is that, yes, if we don't have cypress trees, we can still get the same kind of morphology for this landscape, but it's just going to take a lot longer. And so it's going to change the distribution of, like, it's going to change the probability for us to observe this kind of landscape on Earth. So which means the change distribution of this kind, the different types of the morphology on Earth. So this is just a side note. So that is the first question, which we figured out how old this landscape is. It's about 10,000 years old. Now let's move to the second scale, which is at individual depression scale. At this scale, we want to know what is controlling the development of the individual depressions. So this is a picture taken from this site. So this is like the exposed bedrock. This is what it looks like in Big Cypress. And so how does these depressions develop from such a small limestone pit to what it is right now, which is like 2 meters deep in the center and like 50 meters in radius? And what is going to be like in the future? Is it going to keep expanding in radius such that they are all connected? Or are they going to get deeper and deeper and eventually become a synode? Or is it already in equilibrium state? So how do we figure this out? We build a second model, which is a three-dimensional morphodynamics model. And let me first give you some intuition behind this model. So you start off from a small limestone pit with some kind of biology growing on it. And then over time, it develops into a big depression, which is what it is right now. And there's a lot of eco-hydrological feedback involved in this process of development. First, you have some biology growing there, and that is going to create some respirational CO2 in the root zone. And then that root zone CO2 is going to move to the bedrock surface. That's going to accelerate the weathering. And when the weathering rate is high, you are going to increase the basin or the depression volume. And when the depression is bigger, it can hold more water. And so it's going to have longer hydro period. And the period when the basin is inundated is going to also expand, and that is going to accelerate the weathering rate. So this is a positive feedback loop, but at the same time, so it's also going to, because the cypress tree needs water, so if you have longer hydro period, it's going to also accelerate the tree growth. So these are the positive feedback, but also there's negative feedback. If there's a lot of like those really big depressions, if the total amount of the water that goes into the system is the same, then most of the water is going to be captured within these depressions. That means that there's less water left on the landscape matrix. So the period for landscape inundation is going to be reduced, and that's going to reduce the calcium export. And so if the calcium, which is a weathering product, can't be exported out of the system, it's going to reprecipitate, and that's going to reduce the net weathering rate. So these are the feedbacks, and we incorporated all these processes in this morphodynamic model. So we had detailed hydrological process, including respiration, surface transport, and groundwater exchange. And then we had some very simple biological process building the model to represent the growth of these cypress trees. And there's soil accumulation in the depressions and come from the diffusion of the soil from the upland, as well as from the insoluble weathering products from the limestone. And then we also had the limestone weathering process building, which is derived from the first model. So we run this model to see whether this system, which is at this depression scale, has some kind of equilibrium state, and what is the future for this depression going to be like. Here's the result. Right now, the depression is about 50 meters, and we find that it's going to reach some equilibrium at about 80 meters. What you are seeing here on the left is the y-axis expansion rate and x-axis the time. This shows where we are right now, and it seems that we are at a stage where the weathering rate is highest, and it's going to eventually going down and reach some kind of equilibrium state asymptotically. Right now, the depth of the depression is about 2 meters. Eventually, it's going to stabilize at about 7.5 meters. The whole landscape, a quarter of the landscape right now is covered by these depressions, and in equilibrium state, about 60% of the landscape surface is going to be covered by the depressions. So this is the result, but then the question is, what kind of feedbacks are stabilizing the system, why they are stabilizing. So we looked at three different feedbacks. The first feedback is called ET feedback, evapotranspiration. So there's basically two patches on this landscape. This is the cypress patch, and this is the pine tree patch. And the ET rate is higher in the cypress patch than in the pine tree patch. So over time, when this patch expands in its area and this shrinks, then the overall, the mean evapotranspiration rate of the landscape is going to increase. And so if the total amount of the water goes into the system is the same, more water is leaving the system through ET, that means less water is leaving the system through surface drainage and groundwater drainage. And that means that the system is going to get drier faster, and that also reduces the capacity. It's not only reduces weathering rate, but also reduces the capacity for the landscape to export the weathering rate. So this is a negative feedback, potentially could stabilize the system. Second feedback that we looked at is the soil thickness feedback. So from the first model, we got this result, which is that as more and more soil start to accumulate in this depression, so the thickness of the soil increases in depression, the amount, the proportion of the CO2 that's generated by root respiration is going to, the proportion of the CO2 that leaves the system to the atmosphere is going to increase as the soil gets thicker. So less CO2 is going to move downward to the bedrock surface to do the weathering work. And so this is also a negative feedback, right? As you expand in the depression size, you get more soil accumulated, and CO2 it would become more difficult for CO2 to move all the way downward to get to the bedrock surface. A lot of CO2 is just going to leave the system through the upper boundary. Okay, so this is the second one. And the third feedback is called biological feedback. So as I showed you that the system right now is 2 meters in the center. But if you get to 7.5 meters, it's really deep. And then that means that it's going to, the trees in the center will not be able to grow there anymore. And also it's going to prevent the recruitment of the seeds or establishment of the new trees, right? And actually we've already seen, as I showed you at the beginning of this talk, like some of the cypress domes already have these holes in it. And I went into one of these depressions, and in the center, it's basically a lot of trees are already dead because the center is too, the water is too deep there. So eventually it's not going to be in depression shape. It's going to be basically like a donut shape. So this is another feedback caused by the biological biomass establishment. So we use the model to basically evaluate which feedback is most important in stabilizing the individual depressions in their size. We found that the one that's most important is the soil thickness feedback. So if soil gets thicker, less CO2 gets can move to the bedrock surface for weathering, followed by the biomass feedback, and ET feedback is not that important. Okay, so, but there's another thing that's going on in the system, which is the sea level rise. So I told you that the system is going to stabilize in about 200,000 years from today. And this is just a theoretical prediction. And we know that there's sea level rise in the area, and it is projected that maybe like in less than 80 or 100 years, this area is going to be probably inundated by seawater. If not within the 100 years, definitely within the next 200,000 years. So these cypress depressions will stabilize and reach some equilibrium state, but they're probably just going to be in equilibrium state under seawater. And this is actually being observed in some other system. What you are seeing here is some kind of topography on the sea floor off the coast of the Arabian Gulf and Red Sea. And this is not model output. This is actually a topographic image from the sea floor. What they see is this kind of regular patterned depressions on the seafloor, and it could be caused by this kind of process that I just described. And another thing that was really interesting is that they found, 2 years ago, they found that a cypress forest under the coast, about 20 meters off the coast of the Alabama, and there's a whole cypress forest on the seafloor. And it was, according to the dating, these forest, these cypress trees on the seafloor is about 50,000 years old. And we don't have the topographic data yet, but maybe there's some kind of, you know, these kind of depressions also associated with this ancient cypress forest. Okay, so going back to this slide, this is, we just talked about this scale, which is to address the question of what controls the size of the depression. Now let's move to last scale, which is to address the question of what causes this over dispersion of these of these cypress domes. Why are they evenly spaced? It looks like as if they are pushing each other away. So for this scale, we built a third model, a landscape evolution model, to address this question. And we have two hypotheses. First hypothesis has to do with this mechanism of scale-dependent feedback. So I've already showed you this slide at the beginning, how this works. And what all we need to do is to replace this desert bush with this cypress dome. So this system is also water limited. It's kind of weird, like it's in Florida, cock can't be water limited. Well, it is water limited because it has an extended dry period in this system. And so in the dry period, the surface water can be completely gone and even the depressions can dry out. And so imagine there's a depression that starts to develop at this place. It's going to, this is creating some kind of positive feedback, because you have depression expanding, water goes into this depression, and then that the depression is going to further expand, creating even bigger depression and hold more water. So this is a positive feedback here. So that will suppress the growth of a second depression within this area. And the second depression can only grow when it is outside of this negative influence zone of the first depression, right? So this is a scale-dependent feedback that I already explained. So this is the first hypothesis. The second hypothesis that we were thinking is this competition mechanism, which does not involve this, like the negative feedback that I just talked about in the first mechanism. So in geomorphology, there's actually a lot of these kind of regular patterns, and geomorphologists have known this, like for two decades, like there's a lot of literature in the past 2 decades about this kind of regularly, what they call is called autogenic landforms. And so these are like, what you are seeing here is evenly spaced ridge and valleys. So they are evenly spaced. And the mechanism that causes this kind of evenly spacing is through competition. So imagine this is one catchment. It is growing and it has its own equilibrium state. And there's a next neighbor is another catchment, which is also growing. It has own equilibrium state. And at some point they're going to run into each other, and there's a divide between these two catchments, which is a ridge. And so each of these catchment has its own development course, and then there's going to be some kind of repeated adjustment of this device movement, and eventually what they will get is these two catchment is going to develop into similar size, and what you will get at landscape scale is this kind of evenly spacing of the ridge and valley, ridge and valley. So this is a mechanism that's known in geomorphology, and it's a competition of different catchment for water, and area here is a proxy for water. So it was really interesting, like the collaborator, Brad Murray on this project, he is a really famous geomorphologist, and he's been working on this kind of regular patterns in geomorphology like for a while, but he has never heard of this thing called scale-dependent feedback that we are so enthusiastic about in ecology. And when I told him about this scale-dependent feedback, he was just like, oh, that's like magic. And so I started to read this kind of like literature in geomorphology and start to think about maybe there's something similar going on in big cypress. It's not necessarily just scale-dependent feedback, right? So we build a model, this landscape evolution model, that incorporates both the scale-dependent feedback through subsurface water movement and this competition between depressions for water. So this is this is the landscape of the depression. So these greens are the depressions, and there's some kind of very subtle network that's connecting them. So you can imagine that each depression has its own catchment. That's where the water flows, water from that catchment is flows into that depression, right? So each depression has its own catchment, and then the catchment can compete for water, basically competing for area. And if there's this kind of competition going on, you can also get regular patterned landscape. So we had a model that incorporate both mechanism, and we want to know which one is actually going on in this landscape. So what we did is that we had this model with two mechanisms going on, and we turned off one mechanism. The first one, we turned off the competition mechanism, and this is what we get. We do not get these kind of depression patterns. Instead, we get some kind of like network labyrinth-like patterns. The next is what we turned off the scale-dependent feedback mechanism. So when we turn off the scale-dependent feedback with only competition mechanism going on, we actually get evenly spaced depressions, except the size of the depressions we get from the model is a little off from what we observe. So it is only when we have both mechanisms, the scale-dependent feedback and the competition mechanism both turned on, can we get not only the pattern right, but also get the size right. So it seems that the conclusion here, it seems that competition can give rise to this kind of over-dispersed depressions in this landscape. But in order to fully simulate what's going on in the landscape, we also need to have scale-dependent feedback. And this is just the result showing the comparison between model result and the observed pattern. And these two figures is showing that over time, the depressions get more and more regular in terms of their spatial arrangement. In ecology, this kind of in the literature of the self-organization, scale-dependent feedback is like unifying general mechanism to explain it. If you just like search self-organization ecology, you will see this word scale-dependent feedback. No one has really think about other alternative mechanism. And it's just amazing, like there's such divide between different fields, like geomorphology, like they've known this kind of mechanism for a long time, but ecologists just don't know about it. And actually this is the first paper that tried to say that there might be some as a mechanism that can cause this kind of regular patterns. So this is a work by Tanida et al. In 2007. What they propose is that there's this it's the two mechanisms, the competition and scale dependent mechanism together give rise to the evenly spaced fairy circles. So this competition is very different from the competition I'm talking about. I'm talking about a competition in geomorphology, like the geomorphology features compete with each other for space. Here, this is real competition, the biological competition. Here, what they're talking about competition here is these various circles. So there's scale-dependent feedback going on through like the subsurface water flow. But the competition they are talking about here is the competition among termite colonies. So each of these circles here, there's some kind of termite colonies there. And you have to incorporate the competition between these colonies in order to fully simulate these kind of patterns. If you just have scale-dependent feedback, the pattern would not be right. So this is what they found. So that's the story. So this is the third scale, which explains what causes the spatial overdispersion of these depressions across the landscape. And what we found is that it is really the competition among catchment and scale-dependent feedback working simultaneously to give rise to this pattern. Just very quickly about Big Cypress in this area overall, there's a lot of different types of like self-organized regular patterns in this area. So we have cypress domes that I just explained in this talk, and there's this kind of cypress strings, so this kind of teardrop shape. And they are also regular patterned. And there's this ridge slope pattern in the Everglades National Park. They are also regular patterned. And there's tree islands. They are also regular patterns. And all these patterns occur within this region. And there's a lot of like transitions. For example, this one, what you are seeing is at the border of the Big Cypress National Preserve and Everglades. So these two systems bordering to each other. So here, so this is about several miles, so not a long distance. Here you see these depressions and you move towards the east, you start to see these ridge through patterns. So one direction of my research is to look at what is causing this transition of the patterns from, you know, this is a weathering pattern and this is basically a sediment deposition pattern. So what is, you know, the underlying drivers of this kind of pattern transition within this, you know, relatively small area. Okay, that's all I have. I would like to take any questions if you have any. Okay.
Thank you, Xiaoli, for the talk. A reminder to everybody, if you have questions, you can type them on the chat box that is at the bottom of the screen. And in the meanwhile, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
When you were explaining the feedback on the landscape, and it was evapotranspiration, biological activity, and soil thickness, and you studied what's the importance of each of them, I think evapotranspiration was at the end, was the less important feedback. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if that can change with the increase on temperature or global warming, if evapotranspiration will be more an important feedback in that case.
Oh yeah. So we, one caveat of, I mean, the issue of the second model is that, I mean, we are looking at the evolution of the landscape over the course of 10,000 years, but we did not incorporate the climate change in the model at all. We most basically just use the contemporary climate as the condition of the model. And I think with the temperature increasing to what definitely make this feedback like more important. I don't remember like in terms of the relative magnitude, which like how much difference there is, whether like at some point the ET feedback is going to become like more important. That I don't know.
Okay. And what type of communities, biological communities, live on these cypress domes?
What kind of?
I'm thinking more on herbivores and what type of other organisms, aside of the trees, live there and interact with the landscape?
Okay, I'm really bad at names of the trees or the species. I think the only thing that I know is like there's some of the willows there. It's like it's not only cypress trees. Some cypress domes are actually dominated by willows, not cypress trees. For animals, I think there's a lot of alligators there. So alligators will dig holes there sometimes. And what other animals? I don't know. I mean, I'm like just so bad at these other species.
Okay. I don't see questions. Oh, there we go. So Alicia Sally is asking, I'm not sure of the water tables and tidal intrusions to some of the southern Florida sites, but I'm curious whether or not you have seen differences in the chemical conditions of the water table and how that relates to dome size and structure.
I think Okay, so we do, part of this project was actually to look at that. It was led by Matt Cohen's group. I think there's some kind of saltwater intrusions into the system, and there's like the salinity is decreasing. Oh, sorry, it's increasing, and we see signals of that. With all these models, does not include that at all. And I think in terms of the if the saltwater intrusion into the groundwater, and that's going to definitely change the chemical conditions of the groundwater, and that is going to change the weathering rate definitely, because that's going to change the pH condition of the chemical kinetics that we did in the first model. How that's going to change the weathering rate and the dome size. I think in the dome structure, I don't think the shape of the dome is going to change in terms of the weathering rate and its size. Okay, so salinity increases. Let's see. I think it's going to reduce the weathering rate, right? If you have the salinity increases in the lower boundary of this system. And yeah, I'm not sure, but it's definitely going to change it. I don't know which direction is going to change it.
I'm gonna keep asking just because we are running out of time. And Alison Berry is asking Moses, other ground cover, nitrogen fixing associations could affect nitrogen budget.
Yeah, I mean, the ground cover, the system is outside of the depressions. There's some pine trees, but between pine trees, it's like exposed bedrock. There's not a lot of biomass. It just exposed bedrock. You can see like this, there's not a lot of sediments deposition or soil deposition on the upland matrix. It's just exposed bedrock. So there's like cypress tree, willows within the depression, and then outside of depression is pine tree, and then exposed bedrock.
Okay. Albert Carranza is asking, are the roots in the center of a dome deeper or larger? If so, does that contribute to the growth of the depression?
I think so, because you see that the trees in the center is larger before they die if the water is too deep. So the trees is big. And because it's deeper water there, so the cypress trees needs water, and then they grow better. They are less water limited, and so the trees bigger and roots bigger, and then you have more biological respiration in the center, and that is increasing the weathering rate. So within the depressions, locally in the center, it is has higher depression. Higher weathering rate than the ones on the edge. So there's this heterogeneity in the weathering rate within depression too.
Thank you. And I'm going to end the seminar here because it's past 2 p.m. So thank you so much, Xiaoli, for this amazing talk. And you can see all the all the thank yous on the chat if you want. And thank you all for attending.
Thank you.